Hello and welcome. This is Nature First, Geoffrey Campbell, on my first podcast on the subject of hiking, biking, and otherwise enjoying the outdoors. This is podcasting from Tucson, Arizona, my home currently. This is separate than the podcasts of my brother and I, the Border Brothers. We will have some content coming at a later date that'll probably be much more entertaining and engaging than the piece that I'm going to go over today. But I wanted to first say that any of the advice that I offer is just anecdotal. They're stories from my own experience. By no means am I an expert, and I have a lot of respect for the true professionals that are guiding and taking guests on adventures in this wonderful age of transformative travel that we live in. And I will be discussing things that impact me, not in a selfish way, but hopefully so that I can help you start your journey or maybe influence your current journey as you get acclimated to the great outdoors. A little bit about me. I'm 40 years old. I grew up in Carmel, Indiana. However, when I was a teenager, I had the opportunity to attend Skinner Brothers Survival School, and it changed everything. When I was younger, before that point, I was involved with Cub Scouts, and we had a wonderful forest in our backyard and a bubbling creek. And my brothers and I spent a lot of time out there exploring and playing, and so nature has really been second nature, no pun intended, to myself and my brothers. There was a journey along the way before I got here that involved Newport, Rhode Island, having twin boys in Boston, Massachusetts, moving back to Indiana, having a daughter. My wife and I moved up to Michigan, got to explore Michigan for a while, beautiful state. And I went to Tucson, and I was managing a dude ranch called Tanca Verde Ranch. And then I got the call to go with the GM to Escalante Grand Staircase area. And it was at this area that I worked in Amangiri. And at the same time, I was really developing a love for the great American Southwest. I got the call to go manage a glamping resort up in Montana, in Greenough, Montana, which is very far south of Glacier and a little north northeast of Missoula in the western Montana Rockies, the northern Rockies there. So, and then I returned to Tucson, and I've really made this my hub for exploration, both personal exploration as well as connecting with others that have a love for preserving these gifts in nature that we have. So the first subject that I'm going to go over is kind of interesting. I'm kind of skipping around, but this is kind of important in regards to planning a trip. And pacing is actually a survival skill. And when I talk about pacing, I'm talking about something really simple, right? When you look at a map and you decide, hey, I want to do this. What am I going to need to bring? What are some of the risks involved, and how long is it going to take me? Any supplies that you bring or anything you plan for is time-based. So we're going to be talking about pacing as a survival skill. So looking back on historic data from July through mid-November, I've averaged about 2.18 miles per hour, or a 27.56 minute mile while hiking in both the Santa Catalina Mountains and the Tucson Mountains. I'm an avid hiker, but I have a very individualized approach as we look at challenges faced by both distance and elevation gain. I would consider myself a hybrid as it relates to trail running and recreational hiking. If something does catch my attention, I'll most likely stop and investigate whether it's a plant, an animal, or a particular geological feature, or a combination of any of these things. In other words, I take the time to smell the roses in between intervals of high-intensity aerobic and bursts of anaerobic activity. The goal of hiking for me combines the beneficial emotional impacts of relaxation in nature with vigorous fitness objectives. In order to do this while avoiding injury or fatigue, I've become extremely knowledgeable in how my own body works and how it does not. After an incident being airlifted out of a canyon and a series of disappointing blood work results, I knew something was wrong when everything else seemed right. So I weighed over 265 pounds a little over 2 years ago and reduced my weight to a range between 170 and 190. While this was a great transformation, it did come with some serious health considerations. I'd inadvertently developed anemia from training hard in the dry desert sun. I continued to push hard and had diminishing results as it relates to muscle cramping, fatigue, and poor white blood cell and red blood cell health. I didn't know these things until I visited a doctor, which was after I had found myself limping along the Pima Canyon Trail out of energy on my way down from an 8-hour hike high in the mountains. After this discouraging incident, I took up mountain biking. However, I found a similar pattern of muscle cramping and atrophy after intense sessions. To make a long and complicated story short, I reversed the results of my blood test. I gained 20 pounds of lean muscle, and I can now enjoy miles upon miles of joy on the mountain biking and hiking trails. What worked for me may not work for everyone. However, what I can say is this, is that you have to measure as much as you possibly can when you set goals involving dangerous environments. I used to think being prepared was limited to what deliberations I took packing my backpack and what route I was going to take. While packing for a trail run, hike, or mountain biking adventure, it's necessary for emergency preparedness, and it can make the difference between life and death. If you don't know your own physical limits and constraints, it can be even deadly if you're not prepared. So part of knowing your physical limits involves planning your trip based on not only the elements you're about to encounter, but knowing how they will affect you personally. These things, which I found out, can't be learned in books, and sometimes experience isn't enough. You need to know the state of your own health, not just how you look in the mirror or how you feel, but what's going on at a cellular level. Each year, hikers die on established trails. As you could probably guess, there are correlations between the frequency of life-threatening injuries and the environment encountered on various trails. Our own common sense is not enough when it comes to making trip decisions that involve risk. This is compounded by the casual, obsessive relationship with nature people have today. Social media is filled with selfies being taken by otherwise normal people doing extraordinarily dangerous things in remote areas, often isolated from emergency response teams. This imaging can be misleading as it relates to risk management, but nonetheless, it still has a profound effect on the consumers of the media. That being said, here's an excerpt from an interview I had in June 2016 with Tucson News Now concerning the death of a few hikers in one of my favorite trails here in the Santa Catalina Mountains. Meanwhile, Hacienda del Sol Resort, which is close to the Finger Rock Trail, said their guests are also filled in on the dangers of heat and even wildlife. These new signs listing the animals guests might see during their stay will be posted throughout the resort as a way to inform the guests but also warn them. When you're having fun, sometimes you forget about the risks, says Hacienda del Sol assistant manager Geoffrey Campbell. That's why we're always recommending going on a hike with a professional guide or with one of our staff members for a history or wildlife walk. Campbell also said they keep extra hiking equipment on hand in case the guests need them. Even if you're going to bird, there's still some risks, said Campbell. It's always good to go with an expert because while you're distracted having your fun, it's good to have someone watching over you. So the risks mentioned above, for me now to articulate to other athletes that may have had a false sense of security in this environment due to their own experiences in different environments. And when I say that the risks mentioned above are easier for me to articulate to other athletes, I'm not considering myself an athlete, but I'm considering myself a little more aggressive athletically than maybe most people that are on the trail. I saw a shift from me laboring along the trail and being passed frequently to being a trailblazer myself. And I say that in the most humble of ways. It's taken me several years to build up the stamina and the setbacks I mentioned before I could really enjoy the trails at my own level of fitness. But what I would say to myself and other athletes is that you really have to be cautious, because this environment is so much different than wherever you're training. And that goes for any environment that's different from what your body is used to. I thoroughly recommend listening to Outside Magazine podcasts. In particular, I found the Science of Survival episode 17, Drinking Yourself to Death, extremely valid to my own experience. Basically, you'll not know how much water you need unless you weigh yourself before and after exercise in the desert heat. I know this is not feasible for all people, but the story itself is important because we all know how ego and grit can lead our decision making. Even when athletes are highly monitored and educated, they can let emotion interfere with decision making. When you don't know what you don't know, the risk can be deadly, even in the face of arrogance. So here are my considerations in planning an epic hike. Like I said, I'm not an expert, but I hope that my insight and my own bodily limits can help you investigate and apply the principles of science to your next bucket list item. So the first thing we need to talk about is getting physical, meaning get a physical. There are basic considerations that you should be aware of regardless of where you'll be hiking. The first consideration is overall activity level and metabolic health. I strongly recommend making the time and spending the money to consult with a medical professional. You should be honest about your lifestyle and medical history, as well as your outdoor fitness goals. I learned this way too late. I should have done this a decade ago, even 2 decades ago. You're never too young to know where you are. After this process, you'll have the peace of mind of knowing what your current level of fitness is, inside and out, as well as anything you may not have known previously. Also, you'll have a better understanding about how your body may respond to the stress of an unforgiving environment. Sometimes there's things that happen to us that we cannot prepare for because there is no indicators prior to the incident. For example, if you pick up John Krakauer's Into Thin Air, you'll read about the effects of HACE upon Dale Cruz, a 44-year-old dentist and one of the members of Scott Fisher's team. Cruz was having an incredibly difficult time simply trying to dress himself. And I read the book and it was captivating. Just like Into the Wild and other books that Krakauer has written. High altitude cerebral edema, that's HACE, is a medical condition in which the brain swells with fluid because of the physiological effects of traveling to high altitude. It generally appears in patients who have acute mountain sickness and involves disorientation, makes you lethargic, also experiencing nausea and other symptoms. It also occurs when the body fails to acclimatize. How do you say that? Acclimatize. I've always struggled with that word. Maybe someone can help me with that. Acclimate is what I say, but some people call it acclimatize. While ascending to a high altitude. You know what I'm trying to say. The only way to acclimate yourself to a high altitude is time. Outside of... I don't even know how to pronounce that. Acetazolamide. Acetazolamide. Which can also help, but is not a definitive reversal of the condition. High altitude climbs mean that the climber slowly climbs higher and higher as their body adjusts, hopefully. However, for some people, they're simply unable to function in the environment at a certain altitude and must quickly lower their elevation or possibly die. There's no way to fully prepare yourself, for this is an unknown until you're there. So there. Imagine being mentally compromised due to this condition, having spent tens of thousands of dollars on an exhibition, and being faced with a decision to tap out. There's no climber on Everest that does not know the risks and the effects high altitude climbing have on decision making, coupled with unforeseeable challenges both on a human level and environmental level. Yet still, climbers get summit fever and find themselves irreversibly damaged, or worse, dead. These risks are not only isolated to climbing Everest and K2, but they can also be found in all biomes across the world. Granted, some adventures are pretty tame, but there are risks everywhere. These risks are not only isolated to climbing Everest, but they can be found anywhere, like I said. Even taking the trash out, you can find yourself with a head injury. Outside of the unknown, like with HACE, there are some things you can consider based on you. There are things that you can do based on you. I'm using myself as a test subject in this blog. Remember, this is a scientific process, and you must use it personally to determine your current level of fitness and any risks that could be associated with your adventure. So after sheepishly going over some not so good decisions to my doctor, we're very quickly able to fix my blood abnormalities, of which I'm very fortunate for and very grateful for. You see, I created the conditions of which the doctor was concerned about. The only reason I know this is because I was closely monitored and had multiple blood tests taken to measure changes in my blood work over time. Turns out that I had depleted my electrolytes, I didn't fuel my muscles with enough B complexes and vitamins, and I was undernourished during extreme physical activities in an environment which only compounded the issue further. I was losing between 7 and 10 pounds of water through sweat and breathing, even though taking what I thought were carefully considered precautions. These precautions were most certainly important, but I did not start with the first consideration being what I could not see. After I solved the mystery of waking up in the middle of the night with various tear-invoking cramps, many of which didn't go away for 30 minutes, I was able to concentrate on the next consideration of pacing, which is equipment. Remember, if your body's not working and you don't know about your body, don't even worry about pacing yourself. So the next item is equipment. All right, so we just got our physical, we have a clean bill of health, and we know what our limitations are based on the recommendations of a doctor. Now we're going to take a look at our equipment. When you can lower your overall pack weight, you can exponentially increase your efficiency on the trail. And this is a given and accepted philosophy for most hikers. There's even some weight shaming with ultralight hikers where they'll notice that maybe you have a little too much with you, and they'll rub it in your face how much lighter their pack is. You know what? That's all nonsense. You want to take the equipment that's there for you that's important based on what could happen in an unforeseen circumstance. So, if you want to see where you stand among the crowd, you simply weigh your pack outside of water prior to embarking on your adventure. And that's it. So, if you get on the scale and you see what your weight is, you get off, put your backpack on, climb on the scale, there you go. Subtract the difference. Water is considered a second factor. And like I said, it's not because of its importance, but it's another very, very important variable. Just as important as equipment, if not more important. Your pack may be variable too, depending on your goals, but you should have a baseline of non-negotiables for when you hike. And I have my own list of essentials I personally start with every hike. And again, these items would go with me regardless of how long my hike is, unless I'm just going for a jog for a couple miles or whatnot. But I still bring it with me because you never know. So the first thing you want to do is protect your feet. It's essential. I put lots of love in my feet. I rub lotion into my feet. I put bag balm on my feet, coconut oil, whatever it takes to make sure that I don't have broken skin, and I don't want to get infections or strains. So what seems silly is an attempt to keep my feet in tip-top condition for my hiking. I use Ultra Lone Peak Mid 3.5s as my hiking boot of choice. They have zero drop technology, they're light, and they're designed as a running shoe with ankle support. The soles are amazing for traction, and the toe box gives me room to spread out my toes and avoid painful toe problems because I have really weird looking duck feet, and it seems like these were made for me. For my socks, I wear moisture wicking socks, and I keep my feet dry at all times. The next thing you want to protect is your head. Even though at times I like when I'm in the shade, I may avoid wearing my full-brimmed hat, but it's still there strapped to my pack. I use a full-brimmed hat even when I'm using sunblock and a bandana across my neck. It's not only because of protecting myself from solar radiation, but always being conscious of my core body temperature. All right. See here, what's next? Aha! Sunglasses are always a must. However, I wear contacts, so if I choose to have the luxury contacts, I carry my glasses in a separate case along with a small disposable bottle of eye drops and a pre-filled sterile contact lens storage case, just in case, no pun intended. Also, I keep a lens cloth in my pocket for wiping the sweat off my sunglasses and whatnot. Again, when you think of the very bare essentials, we're protecting the very equipment that we're using to protect ourselves, right? In regards to my body, I cover as much skin as possible, even when I'm wearing sunblock. Clothing would take a whole discussion outside of the scope of pacing, but remember the goal of clothing during the hike is to protect the skin from injury and regulate your body temperature. If you understand the mechanics of air conditioning, you have no problem in applying the science to controlling your core body temperature, as well as understand the upper limits in both extreme heat and extreme cold. So inside my pack, including the items we talked about before, I have sunblock and lip balm, essential personal care and medical items, which are not first aid. So this would be my little B12 supplements, electrolyte supplements. I have these little fizzy tablets that are wonderful. And that's a very personal item for whoever you are. If you're a diabetic or if you have conditions, you have to take your meds with you. You never know what's going to happen. That's an essential, and they're generally pretty light. First aid kit, again, essential. It's very small. It has things in it that I use to clean out wounds and keep infection from starting in the first place. So that's what's really important, keeping your wounds clean and covering them. I have a pocket knife. It's small and thin and light. I have a disposable lighter and homemade wax cotton fire starters, and I can teach you how I make mine. They're very inexpensive and fun to make. I have an emergency blanket, which looks like foil, but it's a very thin, reflective plastic sheet that keeps you cool or keeps you warm. It can also be used as a signaling device. As an additional signaling device, I have a whistle. It's nice, it's thin, doesn't take up any space. Don't forget that the universal code for distress is 3 tweets. I carry my map and compass, a bandana, which is always with me, thread and needle, duct tape, toilet paper, a headlamp and tweezers. Most people can't be separated from their cell phone, so that's a given almost. I do have a cell phone, but I also carry a solar charger with me. If you know cellular reception areas ahead of time, otherwise you can carry a beacon or a GPS device. Most of my hikes that I go on, I don't need the beacon, and my cell phone suffices, but that solar charger is a great peace of mind, especially if you're caught in a situation and it takes longer than your battery can withstand and you're waiting. And your phone is constantly roaming, but you're waiting to hear back from emergency personnel or to dispatch, or you're looking for a signal to make that call, it's good to have that solar-powered charger in your backpack. Water is critical. Like I mentioned before, and listen to that Outside Magazine podcast, The water you need to hike in the desert is a priceless commodity. Water planning is as important as pacing, and you will need to know not only how much water you need to survive, but where you can get it. You never assume that there will be water on a trail if it's not historically present 24/7, 365 days a year. There are few areas in the Santa Catalina Mountains that usually always have water, even when the washes and falls are still. This is why I use Romero Canyon and Sabino Canyon trails for my long hikes. Also, they're well traveled, at least in the lower elevations, so I can ask returning hikers if there's water ahead to plan accordingly. After years of trying to find the perfect hydration pack, I found the one that works for me. It is a HydraPack reservoir. It's BPA free. It has a shape shift baffle to change the volume from 2.5 to 3 liters to better fit my pack. It also has a plug and play connector, so it's really easy to clean it and use it for multiple uses. I actually attach my little water filter to it as well, so I can literally scoop up water from the stream into my Camelback. I'm sorry, that's a brand name, from my Hydra Pack, seal it off and stick the water purifier right on the end and drink from the bag. The reason that these items are part of pacing equipment is because if you have an equipment malfunction or you're not prepared, it will slow you down. It's amazing how little things slow you down along the trail. Maybe it's getting dust or dirt in your eye. Maybe it's sweat going across your sunglasses, injuring yourself, and or getting something stuck in your ankle or heel and you need those tweezers to pull it out. It also prevents something that could be a mild discomfort from ballooning into a serious problem, such as a foot injury or a wound that keeps getting aggravated as you're moving along. So that is why we include item two with planning. Okay, so item three, planning distance over time. Okay, so this is what you probably thought of when I mentioned we were going to be talking about pacing. I'm talking about pacing as a survival skill, just so people understand that everything is a safety situation when you're planning how to hike. Planning distance over time is pacing, more or less. And this is what most people think of when they're considering pace. Even where pace is not on their mind, they're usually thinking about pace in abstract terms. How long do I have and how far am I going? To discuss pace, let's consider my last hike from this past Saturday again. I hiked 18 miles starting at the Romero Canyon trailhead number 8. I passed Romero Pass and I went on to the Mount Lemmon trail number 5 over the course of 7 hours and 41 minutes. On this particular hike, I started at 2,700 feet and climbed to 6,695 feet for an elevation gain of 4,616 feet. I kept the clock ticking, even though I did not stop along the way for photos and exploring campsites and a little bouldering. This was a training hike in preparation for the whole Mount Lemmon hike. It's ironic that the distance for Mount Lemmon from the trailhead in Catalina State Park is approximately 13.1 miles, or a half marathon, to hike from the base of Mount Lemmon at Romero Canyon in Catalina State Park to the trailhead for Mount Lemmon. You can do it either way. The Lemmon Trail adds about 3,600 feet in elevation gain to the existing 4,133 gained on the Romero Canyon Trail. Combined, you have 7,722 feet in elevation gain. So, if I were to hike to the top of Mount Lemmon today, how long would it take me? Hey, speaking of pacing yourself, here's what not to do. Don't make arrogant assumptions based on what you see on your trail. For example, may be tempting to size yourself up with other hikers on the trail based on their experience or their appearance and pace and say to yourself, if they can do it, I can do it. This is utter nonsense and has a lot to do when I was first talking about know thyself. I'm reminded of my first full ascent of Mount Kimball, a sky island in the Catalina Mountains, gaining over 4,000 feet in elevation in about 8 miles round trip. Long story short, a man who appeared 20 years my senior saved my ass by offering me water, advice, and hope. I would not have made it without passing by this gentleman. By this gentleman passing by me, I would say. He was a superhero to me that day. His pace after our interaction was brisk but confident and impressive. Never caught up with him again, and I've never seen him since, but I learned a lot from my observations of both how he aided me as a distressed hiker and how he handled himself in that situation. I could talk about that later, but let's go back to Mount Lemmon. Let's crunch some numbers first, then I'll introduce some methods of trip planning, since this podcast is really about planning a safe and enjoyable hike under time constraints that you set, not me or other hikers, but you. The first part of the hike from Romero Canyon Trail to Romero Pass is approximately 7.2 miles, with an elevation gain of 4,133 feet. This part of the trail takes you from the high desert among the saguaros to the pine forest in the Sky Island. But also, there's a second leg, the Mount Lemmon Trail. It's also part of the Arizona Trail, which spans from southern Arizona to southern Utah, from the border to border, and it's approximately 5.9 miles in length in this section, and it gains 3,589 feet for a grand total of 13.1 miles, like I mentioned before, forward distance and an elevation gain of 7,722. So anyways, there's two numbers we're looking at here. 13.1 of forward gain and 7,722 feet of elevation gain. If you're a beginning hiker, you probably do not have enough experience to even begin this exercise. Experience is important not only for physical and mental toughness and situational awareness, but trip planning. You see, the more miles you hike, the more data you have to work with. Hopefully you're keeping track of everything. Over the course of 4.5 months, I've hiked 16 different trails, several of which, like Push Peak, I've done multiple times during this time frame. That means I'm averaging about two substantial hikes each week, supplemented with mountain bike adventures every few weeks. There are many variables which have an impact on my hiking time. Ambient temperature and humidity have a profound effect on overall pace, not just moving pace. Also, as I mentioned before, I stop frequently and employ high-intensity interval training principles during my trail hikes and trail runs. I actually move at a slower yet more steady pace during the hotter months and take advantage of cooler months by blasting my way through technical sections and moving at a faster pace between resting moments. In other words, in cooler weather, I spend more time enjoying the views because I can make up for lost time with all-out full sprints and athletic ascents and descents. In hot weather, I try to keep my pulse lower, reduce my perspiration as much as possible, and stretch frequently while moving to avoid cramps and injury. I'm carrying more water in the hot months, which slows me down even more. It doesn't matter how fit you are in the dead of summer in the Sonora Desert. You simply cannot compete with the reality of dehydration and heat stroke. If your core temperature is to remain at approximately 98.6 degrees Fahrenheit in a state of rest, and the ambient outdoor temperature is above 100 degrees Fahrenheit, you're already at a physiological disadvantage, especially when there's no wind. You'll need to keep your skin moist to use evaporation to keep your core temperature in a safe range. If you look at a swamp cooler or an evaporative cooler, which we use commonly in the dry, arid deserts, you can program yourself to act like an evaporative cooler by understanding those principles. Keep your skin moist and keep the air moving past it, and it will, through evaporation, lower your body temperature because of your surface temperature. There are a lot of things to consider when trying to avoid death in the desert, and most importantly, don't be fooled by your perceived level of fitness. The desert has claimed both athletes and amateurs alike, sad to say. Do you remember when I mentioned there are two numbers to consider for our trip up Mount Lemmon? Technology may have changed around us as a species, but for at least the last century and some change, we're somewhat predictable as it applies to pace in general. Speaking of generals, it probably goes without saying that you can be sure that there's some sort of planning involved when you march a military front across the mountains. If you're relatively healthy, then you can use the similar science to predict your own pace. However, as a caveat, I recommend that you do two methods of calculation. The first method is your own experience. The second is applying a proven model to calculate your pace based on as few variables as possible. When you compute these two models, you'll see how similar or dissimilar they are. Chances are you'll be shocked at how close the various models can be when you work with honest facts. Now, you can imagine as a soldier marching across the Alps, or whatever you're doing, you're going to have a heavy pack, you're going to have some heavy boots, but you're going to be in exceptional physical condition. Now, imagine being much lighter as a recreational hiker. You'll be surprised at the similarities because you don't have a pack weighing you down, and hopefully you have some endurance buildup from experience. So these calculations that I talk about base it on a general level of fitness where you can move about the trails and you're fairly comfortable at any given distance. So looking at that, what I wanted to talk about was Naismith's rule. Naismith is a Scottish mountaineer. And it's not that I chose this model because he was Scottish, but because I was shocked with how extraordinarily close his calculations were a couple years ago when I first started using his rule of thumb. But now what I'm finding is that there's more and more of a deviation from what he would predict and what actually happens to me on the trail. I'm trying to articulate this carefully, meaning that I'm now becoming more and more predictable in my levels of fitness and more steady in my pace, and I'm starting to move beyond his model, which, again, it's not a humble brag, but it's just what happens when you condition your body properly. Naismith's rule of thumb that helps in the planning of walking or hiking expedition is calculated by how long it will take to walk the route, including the extra time taken when you're walking uphill. It was devised, like I said, in 1892, and it's really simple when you ignore all the other algorithms and whatnot. It basically means you allow for 1 hour for every 3 miles forward, plus you're going to add 1 hour for every 2,000 feet of ascent or elevation gain. Okay, so looking at that, let me repeat that. 1 hour for every 3 miles forward, 1 hour for every 2,000 feet of ascent on this hike. So let's go back to my data set of 16 hikes over the past 5 months or so. And I have a table here that you can't see, but this performance is from July 1st of 2017 through November 18th, 2017. And it shows each of the hikes, miles, minutes per mile, miles per hour. There are some outliers there from some of my favorite hikes, but in general, it ended up being about 27.56 minutes per mile or 2.18 miles per hour. Now, I decided to grab these routes and some of them, Romero Canyon to Lemmon Trail that I just talked about, 18.01. Miles. Sabina Canyon, I did 11.3 miles. Upper Green Mountain, again, a fairly large distance. Push Peak, 5.32 miles, not too bad. Sabino Canyon Trail, 11.7, heading towards Hutch's Gulch there, Hutch's Pool. Sweetwater Trail to Mount Wasson, 9.9 miles. And there's various elevation gains ranging from the Romero Pass, which was 4,600 feet in elevation gain, Push Peak, which is 2,500. We talked about Mount Kimball, about 4,000 feet. So I grabbed my results and I compared them to what Naismith would have said, looking at forward distance and ascent for each of these. Long story short, after converting them to minutes, I found a variance where with Naismith's estimate, they would have taken 4.47 hours for the data set, whereas my actual performance was 3.86 hours And these results are very close to each other. After working the results over and over again, I found a 16% variance comparing the two. The more data that I, so basically what that means is the more data that I was looking at, the closer the results came. Whereas there's the 4.47 versus the 3.86, that was based on a few, but when we start rolling out all of the data and looking at all of those hikes over time in an Excel spreadsheet, the variance ended up coming closer to 16%. And what I found is that this is due to energy and physics. It's got to be, right? So it doesn't matter if I run in short spurts and rest or go at a gradual pace, it's going to take the same amount of work, more or less. And again, that's very simple, but when we look at it over time, it's pretty reliable and follows the laws of physics and makes sense. After completing my historic model of pacing and Naismith's rule, I found that variance of 16%. The exercise was a great peace of mind when planning trips in unknown territory. My sample of trails was diverse in regards to distance and elevation, and yet I'm fairly close to the mean in Naismith's research over a century ago. The great news for me is that I'm slightly faster than most models I've experimented with. However, the best predictor of performance is past performance. That being said, I anticipate that I'll be moving along at a 2.18 mile per hour clip from the bottom to top of Mount Lemmon. If this is correct, then the overall trip should take about 6 hours to complete based on my own experience. However, I'm going to temper this data with some outliers, namely Push Peak. Push Peak challenges most hikers not in distance but vertical gain. I generally hike Push Peak at a 1.5 mile per hour pace. I can use this data as my slowest possible pace and see what kind of variance I come up with. This exercise would be extremely risky planning the entire Appalachian Trail or Pacific Crest Trail, but for a day hike, it's still valuable when planning the what-ifs. So Push Peak, as a worst-case scenario, would mean that my summit of Mount Lemmon would take me 8.73 hours. My average pace would take me 6 hours, and Naismith's calculation, looking at this, it would take me 7.56 hours. That's looking at 11.1 miles traveled at 3 miles per hour, plus we're adding an additional 3.7 hours due to the elevation gain, which is 7,722 feet divided by 2,000. Given this very valuable information, you're gonna have to plan your water based on season and exposure. I'm utilizing the Romero Pass to reach Mount Lemmon in the winter, or the fall rather, because this, because I know the way that the canyons face and the pitch and prominence of the canyon walls and the time of day and the season, I'll be hiking in a cool, dark canyon until I reach the saddle, at which point I'll be hydrated and ready to go the rest of the distance. I'll be sweating less on the, and the outside temperature will be less, and I'll have access to water at least 4 miles or so into the hike, so water management really begins at the 4 mile mark. So in regards to water management, I will mentally shorten the hike to 7 miles, where I'll depend on my own water. If you watch the video, you'll see in the end my use of naturally occurring water on my last hike that was 18 miles. On the Saturday hike, I cameled up and I drank plenty of water the night before morning of the trip and the trip itself to the trailhead. Also, I made sure to drink heartily on both the approach and the return. I also made sure I was urinating frequently, and I actually urinated 6 times during the trip and dropped in 2 electrolyte tablets in my water reservoir each time I filled it. I use a handy water filter, which can be used by itself as a straw. Returning to my pace, now that we have water covered, I could average out all 3 projections, but this would not be weighted correctly. My average pace is based on 16 data sets, whereas Push Peak is based on 1 particular trail, and 1 is projected by the dead dude who never knew me and probably never hiked Mount Lemmon, meaning Naismith, right? So here's what I'm going to do. Every time you plan a trip, as I mentioned before, you should never go alone. But if you do, you should tell someone when and where to expect you. I've learned that this is better to give a window of time so they don't worry. That's what got me in trouble in the first place. I was 4 hours outside of my rescue or outside of my return window, and my cell phone was dead because I didn't have a charger, and an emergency response was dispatched. When they did reach me, when I was inside of Pima Canyon, I wasn't charged anything, and I wasn't a stupid motorist or a careless hiker. I still had water with me. I had my map. I was following the trail the way that I needed to. I did have some fatigue because of my medical condition. I didn't know about at that time. And when the search and rescue team and Deputy West found me, I said, I'm fine. I just have a few more miles to go. They already had the helicopter there, and they understood how these types of things could happen. And they said, we're already here. We'll take you up. So they airlifted me up. I was spinning around in a circle, 300 feet in the air, going up into a helicopter. And I was promptly returned to a field in a school where my worried and angry wife and daughter were waiting for me. I learned a lot from that trip. My brother's mother, wife, best friend Richard, everybody was worried about me because of my failure to plan an epic trip like this. And this trip was to take me through Pima Canyon to the top of Mount Kimball and down through the Finger Rock Trail, which is a very aggressive route. I was going during the monsoon season and wasn't in the best of physical shape, and I was not prepared with emergency communication devices. So there you go. So because I'm not planning on going up and down, I'll need to arrange transportation accordingly. That said, I'll most likely leave my car in Catalina State Park, take a shuttle down, or perhaps even bribe a friend to meet me at the top. There's a place to eat as well, as medical care facilities are also near the top of the mountain in what's called Summer Haven. So that makes the wait less inconvenient for whoever is going to be picking me up. And if I choose to do the opposite and hike down the mountain, then I'll shuttle up and leave my car at the bottom anyways. Considering this plan, I'll communicate this as such. Should all go as planned, I expect to be on the trail between 6 and 8 hours. Should I lose communication, you should see me in no more than 9 hours. If you do not hear from me after 10 hours, dispatch an emergency response. If I leave at 5 a.m., this would mean call for help at 3 p.m. if there's no contact at all. There's cell phone reception at the saddle, which will be our touch point, right? So basically, this is me talking to somebody. You get the picture and being like, hey, I'll call you from this point. Okay, so in a nutshell, pacing is relatively easy if you're in good health and have a little bit of experience. Be sure to get a physical and start tracking your hikes, and always it's always better to allow more time for adventure. Make sure that you're planned that you're planning communication with the outside world prior to your adventure. And when you're in doubt, always use a conservative method of estimating your pace and bring more water than you think you need. So that's it. That's my first discussion having to do with pacing as a survival skill. I hope it's as helpful to you as it has been for me. And again, I didn't need to take up a full 50 minutes to discuss this, but if you don't listen to anything else and you just want to hear the main points, get a physical. Don't hike alone, but if you do have to hike alone, you need to be in contact with an outside party to make sure that you're pacing as you anticipate you will. And the only way that you'll know your pace is by historical performance coupled with some peace of mind calculations, what a reasonable person would assume you would be able to do. If you've only trained in a gym, on an incline, on a treadmill, that's not going to be good enough. And remember, there's all sorts of factors that are going to be affecting your pace in any environment that's different from what you're used to. I would take a much different approach if I was going to be hiking in Bolivia right now, or even Jackson Hole, Wyoming. Everything is different based on the environmental factors, and you can only do the best you can based on your own historical performance. So get out there, start recording all of your hikes. You don't have to use technology to do so. Learn how to read maps, learn how to pace yourself, learn how to count, learn what a pace is when you're taking steps. That's one thing I didn't mention, but I'll give that to you as another trick in my bag of tricks. Do use an app to measure a mile on flat ground and walk your casual brisk hiking pace. And when you're doing that, you're going to count how many steps you're taking. Like, actually count. Not using your app that tells you how many steps, but how many steps you are actually taking. One, two, three, four. Okay? Also, if you really want to do this the way that I do, and it might be nitpicking, but it's so important, you can download a metronome app, and you can march to that metronome while you're pacing yourself. Find a pace that is brisk but comfortable, and look at the results. Do it a few times as you adapt and you get better at hiking and you get more efficient, because you might find yourself out in the wild where you don't have a compass, you don't have a map, you don't have any technology with you. For whatever reason, you might be by yourself and you have to use landmarks. Pacing is so important, because that's how you are going to keep track of where you are in the wild. Okay? So you started a tree or somewhere, and you focus in on that landmark. You mark it yourself however you see necessary. By the way, there's tree markings. If you're ever used to guiding or going with a guide, that could be another lecture too. But you can learn how to identify tree markings from other people that have gone through there to find your way back home. But the only way you're going to do that is by finding markers, finding things that you can identify if you're panicked and going around in circles. And first, and also don't panic. And that's the first rule. Just stay calm. It's amazing how, by staying still, how resourceful you can be. I always recommend that people stay still and wait for help to find them. But if you're hell-bent and finding your way out of a situation and you know how to pace yourself, you just count and start pacing. And then you mark another location. And then you keep going in such a way until you find high ground or a better landmark where you can be more visible, where you can use your emergency whistle, or you can use your reflective blanket. And then that's where you stay. That's where you stay put until emergency response does find you. Stay put. Your chances of being found are so much better if you stay put. But make sure that you don't stay put in a ditch where someone's not going to find you. If the elements allow it, meaning that it's not a dangerous electrical storm or something like that, find the best place out in the open where you can be a contrast to your surrounding environment, using that reflective blanket or whatever you have, fire or whatnot. But the way you find that place is by pacing yourself if you're looking for it. Okay? I hope this was helpful, and please feel free to give me feedback. If I've said something in error, please let me know, because I want to get better too. Again, this isn't to make myself out to be a professional. It's to help other average Joes like myself and Janes enjoy the outdoors more and move to a more... to a more mindful and nature-embracing lifestyle. It's not as scary as it may seem, folks. So again, this is Geoffrey Campbell, Nature First. Thank you for listening, and I hope you subscribe to this podcast, and please give me feedback. We have a YouTube channel, Nature First as well. On there, you'll see some of the adventures I've had with my wonderful family, as well as some alone. And again, this is not a professional endeavor. This is just something that I love to do. And if I could help anybody become comfortable with the outdoors and change their life for the better, then I'm happy. Because what this does for me is it keeps me healthy and it keeps me mentally balanced. And I feel so good being out there and having a little bit of confidence that I'm not going to be mauled by a bear or fall off a ledge and die. I mean, these things can happen, but there's a great peace of mind in just being prepared. And of course, like I said before, know thyself. Have a great afternoon. Thanks. Bye.